Welcome to this installment of Climate Uncensored, which will be hosted by me, Ingrid Rieser. I'm here with climate scientists Kevin Anderson and climate activist Greta Thunberg. Welcome. I think that the two of you met for the first time about 4 years ago, and it was just a few months before you started your strike in front of the Swedish parliament. And I think so much has happened in these 4 years since then. So maybe we can just start with that. I mean, do you have what do you think it was about this sort of simple act of your one-person school strike that sort of inspired such a strong response?
Well, I have absolutely no idea. I don't think anyone could have anticipated anything like that. Well, obviously, I am privileged. I live in a privileged part of the world. But still, it was unprecedented, the response. I just thought to myself, I just want to do something. Because I had tried to get organized in different organizations and movements before, but that hadn't really done anything, and I didn't really fit in there. Mm-hmm. So I just thought, okay, then I will do something myself. And then I just did, because I thought, if this doesn't work, then I'm going to try something else until I find something that works for me. And then it just did work, and it kind of spiraled out of control in a way. Yeah. So I don't know, just the idea that it's a one child sitting alone, it definitely would not have had the same impact if it was several people, because that's how the media works. It was a good story to report. It was a simple narrative for the media to write about, which made it easier for them.
Do you have some thoughts, Kevin? What do you think had this kind of explosive effect?
No, I have no thoughts as to why it has this explosive effect, but I do think it's absolutely key in a sense. Well, at least for me, and I think for many of us who think, well, what can we do? And I think the trick is we don't know what we can do. And there's some that gives us much more power. If you went back 5 years or 6 years ago and said, who do you think might change the dialogue on climate change? You probably wouldn't say, I think it might be a 15-year-old Swedish schoolgirl. That wouldn't be your first thought. And actually, that tells us that the system is much more emergent. We don't know where those changes are coming from. So I think there's some real hope in that. We're not going to find solutions and responses to climate change that come from the great and the good, from the professors. You know, they're going to come out of the emergent mess that is society, and that requires us all to do our bit in our home, in our schools, our universities, our places of work, where we, you know, do our sports or whatever. And to me, that's what I really like about sort of Greta's storyline, I suppose, is that there you see that the change came out of something that you could never expect. And I think hope resides in that.
Yeah. I mean, there's a saying that there's no silver bullet. But if we take everything that we have and just shoot out at the same time, something will hit something, and that will lead to other things and so on. So just exactly the idea that if we just try from every possible angle, then we might find something that we can hold on to that can have an effect. And it's not that others hadn't been doing the same thing before. Many, many people have been saying the same things for decades. And we would have been nowhere if it weren't for them. Of course, we're in a bad position, but we would have been much worse off if it wouldn't have been for them, paving the way for us today. Like you, for example, have been doing this for a very, very much longer time. And I and the other young activists would not have been able to do anything if it wouldn't have been for people like you.
Well, it's interesting, because do you both feel that you have had this sort of engagement for the environment in general, like basically your whole lives? Because that's sort of what it seems like. And I know, Kevin, even when you were working at an oil platform, you were causing trouble even then for your bosses by reporting on, you know, oil spills that they were trying to hush up and so on. Do you feel like it's been something that's been with you forever?
Well, for me, yes, but only in thinking backwards. I didn't really think of it as the environment or as nature. It's just where I lived. And then as I got older, I really appreciated the beauty of that world and the fun of it, the adventure of it. And then when I worked in the oil rigs, there were practices and things that we were doing that weren't right. We could do them much better. And it also makes you realise that, you know, lots of people care about the environment in a way that they wouldn't ever give it a name, like the environment or climate change. But you know, a lot of the people that work on the oil rigs, I mean, they've got families and children. They do care about their futures. I think it's quite different sometimes from the more corporate end of these institutions. To me, the environment was always there and it's part of what we do day in, day out. But then climate change came along, so I went back to university to find out about it and been stuck in it ever since. I always wish the skeptics were right. There are other things I would rather be doing.
Yeah, same.
Yeah.
Well, I grew up in like big cities, very distant from the natural world. So I didn't have that direct connection. But I think that also was important because then I could see and I could feel this lack of presence. But it was never like, I never got used to these big motorways and airports because I even though I had been living there all my life, it was still something that stood out to me. And I was just like the other children in the way that I cared about animals. I loved animals and I loved just nature as a term that people just used. But I think in that way I was like everyone else. But then when we were told about what was happening to that same world that everyone seemed to love, those animals, and just, yeah, then I could not let that go because it was stuck in my head. Everyone else seemed to just leave it and went on with their everyday lives, and I could not do that. So I don't know. I have always cared about many, many issues, human rights and everything, not just about the environment, but it was just such a thing that it was so big because it threatened all the other issues as well and amplified them, injustices and everything. And it just seemed like, if this is such a big issue, then why are we not talking about it? So then I started to read more about it, and the more I read, the more I understood that this is actually much, much worse than I had initially thought. So someone needs to care about this. So then I started to care about this, but no one else seemed to do it.
Speaking of this sort of divide between maybe the what most people think is going on with the environment and the climate, and then maybe what the actual reality is. One of the things that I know you've talked about previously, Kevin, is that sometimes scientists and maybe climate scientists in particular are a bit afraid of maybe saying how bad they actually think it is, or speaking clearly about that. Maybe because they don't want to seem alarmist or don't want people to lose hope that this is something that we can do something about. So what are you guys' thoughts on that?
I could talk for hours on this. This is one of my big bugbears in work as an academic. Perhaps because I came to university later, I came to academia later in life, I had a naive view, and I still have that naive view, that we have a particular role in society. You know, we are academics. We're not NGOs. We don't work for consultancies. We're not, we have a job. And our job in society to help with the rest of all the other multiple jobs that make a society a thriving place to be, our job is to do our work carefully and diligently and communicate it clearly and bluntly, courteously, but never to sweeten the pill or to over-exaggerate it. I mean, and that's our job. And what I found working on climate change is that repeatedly people say, oh, you can't say that. That takes away people's hope. That'll scare them. Or we'll adjust our assumptions to make sure our models fit with the current political framing of the world. And that happens all the time in this realm. Now, it doesn't happen with the climate science that I'm aware of, but it happens with what we should do about the science. So there's a big distinction between what we might call climate science and what we often call mitigation, you know, cutting our emissions, doing something about it. So the climate scientists have done a fantastic job against a backdrop of the oil companies and so forth having huge amounts of money to try and undermine that science. And that still goes on today. But I don't think we've done a good job in saying, well, what are the implications of that for what we need to do in terms of reducing our emissions? And we have sweetened that pill repeatedly. Even this week, I spoke to two, I won't name names. They're two of the most senior people in an organization that we all know of. It's not an NGO, but it's one of the major organizations that frames all this agenda internationally. And both of them said things we can't say in public, what we say in private. Now, I hear that from senior academics, from people like them, from the CEOs of various charitable and environmental NGOs. You know, why is it we think the public and the policymakers can't deal with what it is that we conclude from our research? Why do we do that? That's, to me, that's deeply arrogant to assume that they can't deal with it. Let's not fine-tune our assumptions to fit with their particular economic model that provides the funding for us in universities. We shouldn't care about the interests of the funders. I don't care what the funders want. They fund some research, I do the research, I give them the conclusions. But we should not change the message because we don't think people like it.
Yeah, exactly. So many people seem so afraid of taking away people's hope and to be seen as alarmists or to not be seen as neutral, to be like... But I think that is very, very strange. Because when you talk about giving hope to people, hope for whom? Hope for the ones who are causing this destruction, the ones who are not yet aware of the problem. Well, they're not going to care, no matter what we say. But, I mean, for example, for me, I can only speak on behalf of myself, but for me, I don't find it hopeful when they try to sugarcoat the message. That just makes me realize that they are still not ready to tell it like it is, and that will just delay action even further. What I find hopeful is when they say it as it is, no matter how uncomfortable that is, no matter how scary that may seem. But it's not scary because it's actually dealing with the problem. What is scary and hopeless is if we still try to maintain this image that... this false image that we can still save this within our current economic and political system systems without having to change anything, that is not hopeful for me. Hope for me is if we actually say that we need massive changes and we are nowhere near enough achieving those changes today. And also about neutrality, for me it's much less being neutral if you try to maintain this system that we live in, that is much, much more radical than actually trying to change it in order to safeguard future and present living conditions for all life on Earth as we know it. The idea that we could live in a 2-degree warmer world and still maintain our civilization as it is today, it's very, very radical.
Well, an interesting thing is that, I mean, for Fridays for Future, for example, this slogan this demand of listening to the science, that we need to listen to the science, has been very prominent, and it's been taken up quite broadly. But I know that, Kevin, you're also a bit wary of using that as a slogan.
Yeah. In terms of the science, I think the climate science has really developed well, and we should listen to what this climate science has to say about the challenges that we face, and we haven't done that. In fact, that's been deliberately undermined for decade after decade now by the oil companies, but by lots more organisations as well. But I'm less keen on necessarily listening to the scientists, when it comes to what we should do about this. It has elements of science in it. It has elements of social science in it. It has elements of the humanities in it. All of those things are mixed together. It's innately political. Doing something about it is innately political. And there are no optimized science answers to that. Whereas in the science, we can do the neat physics and the science. We can do the calculations and the maths. And we can provide a nice output from that, or an accurate output from that. You can't do that on mitigation. You can't do that in reducing emissions. How you should reduce the emissions in China, the policies you should put in place, the types of technologies you might consider will be different from what you would get in Sweden, and they'll be different from what you would get in Germany. So how we respond to climate change is much more sort of political and cultural. And what we've done, though, is completely frame this response in a particular sort of world view of how the world should be, a particular economic, political view of the world. In 2022, we've used up almost all of our emission space in terms of temperature rise. And so now we face a challenge that is way beyond our current political framing of climate change. So we have to question that. And here I am concerned that many of the scientists who feed into this debate on the mitigation side are unprepared to question that. And so what we have repeatedly done is sweeten the pill. We've turned the dials up on our models that say, let's rely on future generations to develop technologies to remove carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. Because if you do that, you haven't got to say, well, how do we stop a lot of our aviation in the next 1 year? How do we make sure we don't sell any more four-wheel drive cars, but that we phase out petrol and diesel cars by 2025? How do you put those policies in that there are no more houses that are built that are over 150 square meters, that people don't have second homes, and all of those things that have meant that we're consuming as individuals, both energy and broader sustainability issues, you know, way above any level that is sustainable. And there, I think we have to be careful about listening to the scientists, because I think, you know, we are, on mitigation, I think we're part of the problem. I call it mitigation denial. We deny, and those of us who have worked on the climate science often deny what that science requires us to do. That's, and to me, that's mitigation denial. So I'm cautious about how we use that language.
Yeah, exactly. Individual scientists very seldom have the courage to tell it like it is. Because as we spoke of earlier, they are very afraid to appear as alarmists or to not be neutral and etc. When it comes to science, and especially climate science, we need to be able to look at the results and connect the dots ourselves in many cases to read between the lines. Because often the results are being very watered down by communication experts. As you say, there's this kind of disconnect between what the results say and how individual scientists, many of them, actually communicate the results.
I wonder if it's also a question of democracy as well, because if you have a group of scientists, such as in the IPCC working group 3, where they're then trying to give suggestions or scenarios as to how we're supposed to respond to these climate challenge, since it's inherently political and a social issue, does it not also then need to be responded to in democratic institutions? What do you guys think about that?
Well, we certainly need to get wider inputs into all of these debates, whether through the formal democratic institutions or not, whatever mechanisms we may need. We need to get more people involved in the debate. And it's exactly in that sense, I think Greta's point is absolutely key here, is that completely marginalised in this debate are the people who have been impacted by climate change. And so when I discuss with policymakers in the UK about these issues, you almost never have sat at the table someone else there who's actually living through the impacts of the things that we're discussing. And actually, if we had them there, I think we would think what would be possible for us to discuss would change almost immediately. The sorts of policy realms that we'd consider would change immediately. When they're telling us about what's happened to their families, to their communities, we'd start to think, actually, we can put in much more sort of significant sets of policies now, because now we've heard this narrative. But we live, particularly many of us who are causing this problem, we live in relatively, you know, for us, fortunately, geographically insulated places from the early impacts of climate change. So we're not seeing them in our day-to-day sort of living, as these other people are living through those things and dying as a consequence of them. And I think bringing that, so that democracy is not just within our own boundaries. I think that democracy for climate change, because it's a system, global system level issue, that democracy has to be much, much wider than that. And I think that's one of the reasons we've failed. Every country is still carried on with the sorts of ways we've done things in the past. But the problem is those impacts are way beyond our geographical boundaries now. And they, of course, they will eventually play out within the UK, within Sweden. They're going to come, and they're already starting to do that. We're seeing some of these early signs of the impacts hitting the wealthy parts of the world. But they've been hitting the poorer parts of the world for a long time. So I think we need to, if we are going to democratize this, or we'll be careful about ensuring we don't democratize it just to the boundaries that are convenient for us. We've got to go to those boundaries that are deeply inconvenient for us. Because I think by doing that, we'll open up new policy narratives and what we can do about climate change.
Yeah, exactly. Democracy knows no borders. We have to, when we talk about democracy, it's most often like we have to go and vote every 4 years and so on. But we forget that democracy is so much more than that. It's every hour of every day, everywhere. Yeah.
But I think we often look to leaders as being sort of top down. And I think, I mean, yeah. Greta herself has demonstrated that leadership can be bottom up, but so have many other people. You know, history is littered with great changes that are driven by, often catalyzed by one or two people that are seen, but that's obviously fed into by all the rest of the emergent system around them, if you like. Yeah. But then that can then bring about change. And ultimately, then that feeds into the sort of top-down sort of framing of policies and regulations and even culture. So it's this, I often use this language, this messy relationship between bottom-up and top-down. But leadership is not just top-down. Leadership is as much, if not slightly more importantly, bottom-up. And so to recognise it like that, so leaders occur in our homes, in our schools, you know, everywhere, as well as within prime ministers and the great and the good that we're more familiar with. And I think we have to get away from leadership being that, you know, we're waiting for them to come up with the good ideas. Well, we'll be waiting forever because they're reliant on us and the rest of us to come up with the good ideas and feed them into the system. And then that messy process eventually brings about change. But it isn't a top-down view. It's a much more of a partnership, messy partnership between bottom-up and top-down.
Yeah, completely. I think the leadership that we are seeing from the so-called leaders are not... I don't think that is leadership as it should be defined. I think that we are seeing much more the grassroots movements and people, individual people stepping up. That is much more leadership than whatever they are doing. We are right now at a time where in order to protect democracy, we need to protect not only democracy, but also the climate and everything that we know and care about. We need to be active citizens. We need to actively go out on the streets. We can't just be passive citizens anymore. We need to be active. That is protecting democracy. And that is also how we solve, or I don't know how to put it, the climate emergency. Because the changes that are required now to stabilize, this planet and to safeguard present and future living conditions, those changes are not possible within today's economic or political systems. So that's why we need... And those changes are not going to come from top down. They are going to come when enough people are demanding them, are going out on the streets and making resistance, showing that they want those changes. When I speak to like politicians or like elected officials, they often say that we have to bring the public along slowly because I don't have enough support to go through with these policies. But I do think that there is much bigger support than we think. Because I don't think that people have found the right way to express these wishes. And I think that many, many people want actually this to happen. When I talk to people in general, basically everyone agrees that we need to protect the planet. We need to move away from this destructive, extractivist system that we have now. In order to something completely different. Most people agree with that, at least that I meet. But we need to show that, we want that, and to be very loud and clear about that fact.
But isn't there, in that as well, I think that's a really hopeful message, but I think you could add a bit more hope to that. Actually, some of the policymakers I talk to privately also agree with that.
Yeah.
And actually, I often hear this, that everyone says it's another group, if the policymakers say, well, we would do it if people would vote for it. Yeah. The voters say, well, we'd do it if the leaders...
Everyone is waiting for each other. That's creating this kind of vicious cycle that we can't break. So someone needs to break that.
But it does mean there's a bit of hope then. If in every group, and I hear this again from companies, say, well, if people would buy the products, we'd make good quality things. And so if that's the case, then maybe it's not, once we actually do break through, once there is that break, it can actually quite rapidly shift to a different structure. So we haven't, it's not that we're going to have to wait decades to get this. We haven't got decades on climate change, and we haven't got it for some of the other sustainability issues either. But it might well be, it's just around the corner. And again, that's another message of hope. If it might be around the corner, we can't see that till it arrives.
Yeah.
But then that's why it's worth striving for, because effectively, most people, whether they are the policymakers or the public or the wider citizens or wind companies, you know, many people in those groups see the same thing. They want this change, whatever this change might look like in the end.
Yeah, that is very, very hopeful. And this social tipping point, I mean, that we are waiting for, we might already have passed it. It might just be a delay that it will, I mean, we don't know. These changes can come very rapidly. We can see that throughout history, things can change very, very quickly. Not the least when we saw the corona pandemic, our behavior changed almost overnight in what was acceptable and what was not acceptable. So that teaches us something that can be very valuable in the future.
And I think, so not only did the corona one tell us about how we can change structures and norms and behaviors and what's acceptable in society quite rapidly, but the banking crisis also told us, and we're not short of resources. The banking crisis, overnight, we found money through various techniques.
Also in the pandemic.
Yeah, and in the pandemic as well. So we're not short of resources. And those resources is not just about money, because money is about labor and materials and resources. We have plenty of these to make the changes that were necessary.
How do we try to meet the climate challenge and go through the transitions that we need to do, but without negatively impacting sustainability factors, social factors, cultural factors, and things like democracy as well? Because, I mean, one thing during the pandemic as well was that certain democratic processes were also suspended, and some changes in behavior were not voluntary, or many of them were not voluntary. So how do we navigate those challenges?
That is probably the biggest question that we have. Might be the biggest question humanity has ever faced. I don't think there's an easy response to that. But obviously, the climate crisis is rooted in so many causes. It is rooted in colonialism and the idea that some people are worth more than others and therefore have the right to steal other people's land and resources. Extract. It is also rooted in the idea that we can have endless growth on a finite planet. And of course, we have to address them while we address the climate crisis, because we can't solve the climate crisis with the same mindset that got us into it. We hear a lot now about things that can be described as green colonialism. For example, that we should build a mine on indigenous land to extract minerals that we can use to build electric cars. And that is completely the wrong mindset. And we need to move away from that as fast as possible, as soon as we can. We need to have an intersectional perspective of the climate emergency. The fact that some people have been causing this problem, they have names and addresses, these people who have been causing it. And there's a very big majority that have not done a lot at all to cause it, and yet they are the ones suffering it from its cause consequences the most. So therefore, the aspect of justice and equity, intersectional, that needs to be at the very root of the solution. About democracy, I think we have authoritarian regimes have shown that is not the solution to the climate crisis. The solution will come from people. It will come from the bottom up, and that is only possible in democracies. And of course, since the climate crisis will jeopardize everything, it will jeopardize our whole civilization, and in doing that, it will also jeopardize democracy, obviously. So that's protecting the climate is also protecting democracy and protecting the climate can only be done through democracy.
I'm trying to find some disagreement yeah. between us, but I'm struggling to find that. but I think one of the things I think on your question, and it's one that I regularly hear, is that, you know, okay, a lot of people accept we've got these real problems of this extractive world that we live in. And now we're kind of trying quite rapidly shift at least the physical infrastructure, which is not the only thing we've got to change, but at least the physical infrastructure, we've got to quickly shift that to something quite different. And that in itself requires lots of materials and has a lot of additional issues. But I think that misses, that's true, but it also, I think, repeatedly misses the key point there, that climate isn't bolt on to business as usual. It is in the policymakers' mind at the moment. It is in virtually all the CEOs of the companies. It's still just a token gesture that they bolt on to business as usual. But we're not going to respond to climate change like that. It's just going to get worse. That's why we're failing, because of that mindset. And so if we are to respond to climate change, we're going to have to do things fundamentally differently. And I think that comes back to this issue of equity, that we don't need to extract more. Hopefully we can extract less, even in making this physical transition. But we'll have to shift what we use it with this extractive materials for. And so to me, I often use this language, and this is an equity issue as much within countries as between countries, is that the resources and the labour that furnish the luxuries of people like me, the relatively wealthy in our society, who are a small proportion of our society, maybe 10, 20, 30%, but not the majority, those labour and resources are no longer going to be providing us with second homes or nice cars or second cars or whatever, all the other things that we've got used to, we've normalised in our lifestyles. Those labour and resources are going to be putting in the public transport infrastructure in every decent town and city. They'll make sure that we've got some charging points in the rural environments for rental car schemes that we might have there. They'll make sure that our houses actually are very efficient so that actually people don't have to sit in them. In the UK, we have at the moment, some of the poorer families, even some of the medium income families, choosing between eating and heating in one of the wealthiest countries in the world. The houses should be so well built that that's not the case. So that's a huge job to do. That's lots of labour, lots of materials, but not on top of the ones we're currently using. You know, we need to make sure we don't do the sorts of many of the things that we're doing today. And we move that labour, those labour and resources across to making this much more positive change to the physical infrastructure of our society. That's not enough. We need to be remoulding a lot of our institutions and so forth as well. But we have to recognise there is a big physical component to responding to climate change. You know, building all the renewables, all the public transport, improving our homes, all of that is going to take a lot of labour and resources. It's also a great jobs agenda for the next 20 years or so. We need to start, and we can't wait for 20 years. We have to start it yesterday. But so for many people, responding to climate change is a really positive thing in that sense. But for those people like myself who have consumed and continue to consume far more resources than is any way reasonable for people like me to have, I like to think I'm worth it. You know, people like me, we use that expression, you know, you're worth it. Well, we're not actually. You know, there are lots of other people out there who are worth it, and they need the labour and resources to help them with their homes, with their physical infrastructure. So it's not that this is on top of what we do today. It is instead of how we do things today. And so I think we don't have to extract more. We hopefully can extract less. And we certainly need rules around it to ensure that we're extracting better, if you like. So we are concerned about Indigenous people's rights. We are concerned about the pollution that's occurring in some of the other parts of the world. Apply the regulations that we use in our own rich countries. So actually the extraction in the poorer countries, if we are going to get materials from them and treat them fairly.